and slowly answered Arthur from the barge.
Yeah.
The old order changed. These sobering words have become characteristic of this moment that we share today. While such was often quoted by my father in the gospel, reflecting his knowledge, his flair, his humility, it became all too real in these last 2 years. The old order changes. After a valiant fight against a pervasive and unrelenting foe, the old order changed. Diagnoses, treatments, surgeries, pills upon pills upon pills. But in the darkness of a sunny afternoon, the old order changed. The tongue of the learned became silent in prayer. That knowing, penetrating gaze became a desperate questioning search. And the lion's roar became an exhausted sigh. The old order changed, leaving us with the challenge of finding peace and strength to move forward in our purpose. To the family of Arnelious Crenshaw, we thank you. Thank you for sharing this great man with us. Your sacrifice of time, energy, and sometimes stability have not been unfruitful nor forgotten. So many people have become more. Many congregations have become better because you allowed and even challenged Brother Crenshaw to be more. And our gratitude is inexpressible. To Dolly especially, our hearts overflow with wide-eyed admiration.
Amen.
You arose as the shining champion in the gritty part of this moving saga. Your strength, kindness, faithfulness, and patience epitomizes the marital vow for better, for worse. We honor you today. Dedicate ourselves for your comfort in this time of loss. Yes. To the Northeast Church of Christ, her minister, Dwayne Case, her leaders and staff, your great loss is indicative of your great gift. Arnelious was a transformative leader, building people, setting systems in place, while casting a vision of transcending effectiveness. What he has instilled in you as a congregation, and in you, Brother Case, as the teaching preacher, is a sure foundation for ministerial success. Our hopes are with you. To all who are here to celebrate the life of our brother, we pray for your comfort. As has been said many times in this program, Brother Crenshaw had a unique way of of making everyone feel that they were especially important and close to his heart. The trick of this charm is that you actually were important at that particular time. He would love you with a right now love. And when he saw you again, he would just pick up where he left off. And so we will miss our brother, our father, deeply. Memories flood my soul at the thought of the man Arnelious Crenshaw. Time and mind are not sufficient to adequately tell the stories of the storyteller. For over 30 years, it's been my privilege to sit at his feet, to learn his manner, and witness his process. Not only as a minister, not only as a man, but even as a person. I remember great laughter. I remember good eating. I remember strategic planning and compassionate ministry. The greatest memories that I have of Brother Crenshaw is when he would stand before the people, open up the great text, read it well, give the sense, and give the meaning. Arnelious was an expositor extraordinaire. His ability to explain the ancient texts, giving relevant contemporary application with compassion and consideration for the listener, was always edifying and often remarkable. It is without doubt that our brotherhood has been blessed through his efforts.
Amen.
Gaining a better respect and a more honorable approach to the Holy Writ. I can think of no better way to honor his life right now than to invite you to the text. Acts chapter 20, verse 17 through 38. Luke records the final journey of the Apostle Paul. Paul, that great expositor of the mysteries of God. Paul, the bridge building apostle.
That's him.
To the Gentiles, the ambassador of reconciliation with God and man, and thereby man and man. Though Paul came late to the faith, though he came broken and scarred by faithful decisions,
right, sir.
God's grace was sufficient. Paul said at one point, I am least of the apostles and not worthy to be called an apostle. But then he says, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And by God's grace, he labored more than they. At first, Paul was not readily accepted by the church in Jerusalem, who questioned his loyalty. He was often mistrusted, misunderstood, and mistreated. But even as he says in this text, But none of these things moved him.
Yeah.
His response to such criticism, such suspicion, was to keep preaching and teaching the good news. God did his part by sending Barnabas, who would defend Paul's conversion and work to the apostle. Paul was a relational leader. He surrounded himself with both men and women who would catch his fire, learn his manner, and teach others as well. In fact, the study of Acts and the epistles would reveal scores of people instructed and influenced by Paul. Though Timothy and Titus were well known, there were others like Epaphras, Onesimus, Phoebe, John Mark, and many others who were powerful in the kingdom because of Paul's mentoring. Paul was a teacher of the scripture. Making known the good news was paramount to the apostle. Whether in Macedonia in the morning by the river, or Troas at midnight in the upper room, Paul was ready to talk about Jesus. Pulpit or prison, public or private, didn't matter. Revealing, reasoning, alleging, or debating, Paul loved talking about his Savior and building up the kingdom. I believe that if you call Paul at 2 in the morning, waking him up out of his sleep, he could talk to you about Jesus. Now, in this text, Paul shares some troubling news with his ministerial family. He speaks clearly of his diet. He tells them that I'm going to Jerusalem bound by the Spirit. He tells them that I know that all of you who I've taught, none of you will see my face anymore. So he's very clear that he knows he's dying. The second thing that he talks about is that he warns them of the external attacks against their faith. That after my departure, wolves will come. That's bad news. It gets worse. Because he also says that not only externally will wolves come into the flock.
It gets worse.
But internally.
It gets worse.
Y'all keep track now. Internally, men will rise up and lead the flock for themselves. But then he gives the solution. Be watchful. Keep praying. And then he commends them to God. At this funeral, as we draw it to a close, and we are so thankful for all who have come, thankful for all of the speakers, I want you to see an important lesson out of Acts chapter 20. That as the apostle who is reflective of the goodness and grace of God, he lets them know that he is dying, but then he lets them know that trouble is coming. And that they can't do anything about their his dying. There is something that they need to do about this trouble that's coming. This conversation has a powerful human dynamic revealed. And it is this dynamic that presents a challenge for us even now. Luke writes in verse 37, "Then they all wept freely and fell on Paul's neck and kissed him." Watch. Verse 38. "Sorrowing most of all for the words which he spoke, that they would see his face no more."
Right, sir.
I think we missed it. That in this conversation, he has 2 points of sorrow.
Talk show.
One is that you won't see my face anymore. That's sad. Heartbreaking to know that the apostle is going home to be with Jesus. But the other news was that after his departure, wolves, with trouble would come externally. And if that's not bad enough, then trouble would rise up internally. You need to be watchful and prayerful for that trouble. But when it came time to say goodbye, they wept for the wrong trouble. They cried for the wrong problem. They were more concerned about a trouble they couldn't change than focusing on the trouble that they could do something about. The apostle was going home. There wasn't no change in that.
Talk to
David.
And what the apostle called for going home was that you watch the flock, that you feed the flock, that you take care of the flock. Watch them and watch yourself. And I think that's a great message for us even now. Not focusing on Paul's message so much, but I think even here, when we say goodbye to the teacher, I know enough about him to know he was less concerned about leaving as much as he was concerned about us staying. I believe with all my heart that he would want us to focus not so much on the death, but to focus more on the lessons of his life. And he gave us lesson after lesson. Scripture after scripture was ammunition after ammunition. He taught us about a friend at midnight. I think we need to focus on that. He taught us about the blood covenant. I remember those lessons on the shepherd's song. I remember him talking about lessons from the vine keeper or the parables of the kingdom. I even remember a lesson that said, "Come before winter." And if it were up to Arnelious Crenshaw, he want us to focus more on what he taught us rather than the focus on our loss in his life. Amen. The teacher came and God used him to do a great job. Let's honor God by taking the lessons and making our lives better. God bless you. We love you.